CKD is specifically challenging. Why is that? Even though the basic physiopathomechanisms are more or less similar to adults, in certain aspects, pediatric CKD is quite different. The etiologies are different, and also there are unique pediatric issues and age-specific unique clinical problems. And also certain problems, although are just visible now, they can have a major impact during adult life. In addition to that, like all other pediatric issues, pediatric clinical issues, the provision of care in pediatric medicine has to be delivered always by an adult, the parent or the guardian. This mere presence of the parent or the guardian in between the physician and the patient always creates piles of challenges. As pediatricians, we all know that. So today I'm going to talk about etiologies of CKD and identification and management of complications, mainly growth and nutrition, anemia, hypertension, CKD mineral bone disease, cardiovascular diseases, and also management of end-stage renal disease, very importantly, prevention of progression of CKD. I'm actually just going to give an overview of it. It will not be a comprehensive lecture on CKD. Therefore, it is strongly advised you to read about CKD and also see as many patients as possible in CKD try to get that experience. And also, there will be some MCQs at the end of the lecture. So please don't fall asleep. Stay tuned and be alert. So what are the commonest causes of CKD in children? Is it diabetes, hypertension, or something else? Fortunately, the answer for this question, you don't have to do, but I will give the answer. Etiopathologies of pediatric CKD differ from those leading to adult onset CKD. Diabetes and hypertension are the commonest causes in adults, but congenital abnormalities of kidney and the urinary tract, or CACUT, are the leading causes of CKD in children, accounting 48 to 58% of cases. The most common causes are obstructive uropathies and hypodysplastic or dysplastic kidneys. And I'm not going to describe the stages of CKD. I believe that you know that. And there are five stages. And when the children need renal replacement therapy, it's called end-stage renal disease. So these are some data from developed world which compare the etiologies of chronic kidney disease and end-stage renal disease. As obviously, the etiologies should be more or less similar for those CKD as well as end-stage renal disease. But they exist in different proportions in these two entities. The blue bars represent CACUT, and you can see it is the leading cause of CKD. CACUT is still the leading cause of end-stage renal disease as well, but they appear in smaller magnitudes. In the magnitude of the CACUT in end-stage population is smaller than that of CKD. And the red bars represent chronic glomerular nephropathies. Although they exist in small numbers, it is again a common cause of end-stage renal disease. You can see these are from different centers, but like similar settings. So anyway, the comparison of data in different settings may not be quite accurate, but the disparity of these proportions may be due to the different rates of progression of CKD in different etiologies. The disease progression is very slow in CACUT. So some of these children with CKD due to structural abnormalities may not enter in stage during the pediatric life, and some of them may never enter in stage. They may have a near normal lifespan, although they have some impaired kidney function. Whereas those with treatment resistant chronic glomerulopathies, they have rapid deterioration of renal function, most of them entering end stage within 10 years of onset. And also, etiologies differ among age groups as well. So in this graph, you can see that FSGS and other chronic glomerulopathies exist in small numbers in young children, but their prevalences progressively increase during the adolescent age group. Whereas CACUT is a major cause during early childhood, but that their prevalence decline with age. However, the CACUT still exert a major impact throughout childhood. And the etiologies of CKD can vary across countries and regions. Even though CACUT was reported as the leading cause of CKD in developed Western world, chronic glomerular nephropathies is the main reported cause of CKD in many reports coming from sub-Saharan Africa, India, and Southeast Asia, with a prevalence of 30 to almost 60%. So this may be related to the high prevalence of bacterial, viral, and parasitic infections in these countries, or it may reflect the reporting patterns in these countries where mostly those in end-stage renal disease are being reported, and majority of those having CKD may not be reported in these countries. With advances in genetic technology, the distribution patterns of the etiology of CKD have changed. Modern genetic mapping have identified more than 200 single gene mutations, and hereditary nephropathies contribute to at least 20% of cases of CKD that manifest before the age of 25 years. 70% of ciliopathies are due to single gene mutations. What are ciliopathies? They are mainly the polycystic kidney disease. So in childhood, the main polycystic kidney disease is ARPCKD, autosomal recessive polycystic kidney disease, and also juvenile nephronophthisis. And 30% of steroid resistant nephrotic syndrome, 20% of other chronic glomerular nephropathies, and also 17% of CACUT have shown to be due to single gene mutations. And more genetic mutations are identified every year. In addition, the distribution patterns may change in future. With advanced neonatology services, many preterm babies survive into adulthood. And preterm and IUGR babies are at risk of having reduced nephron mass at birth. And it is well documented that the reduced nephron mass will cause hyperfiltration injury and lead to progressive glomerulosclerosis. In addition, exploding burden of pediatric obesity and associated metabolic syndromes predispose the onset of early nephropathy in susceptible individuals. So these risk factors may change the distribution pattern significantly in future. What about the progression of CKD? As we have already discussed, rate of progression of CKD is different according to the underlying etiology. However, rate of progression may be different in two children with a similar underlying disease with a similar baseline renal reserve. This is determined by additional risk factors, which we call multi-hits. And some of these risk factors are modifiable, whereas others are non-modifiable. So what are the non-modifiable risk factors? Some factors are determined during the fetal life itself. These are called, this is called fetal programming. one of the best example as we discussed is low birth weight and those who are born with low nephron numbers, who have a high risk of glomerulosclerosis. And certain ethnicities may have more than one risk factor. For example, African Americans have a higher risk of having hypertension, idiopathic FSGS, lupus nephritis, HIV nephropathy, or even metabolic syndrome. So in an individual having CKD, when they have like more additional risk factors, the deterioration of the renal functions may be much faster. And also, renal functions rapidly deteriorate during pubertal age. This is thought to be due to the rapid physical growth and increased demand with associated disturbed hemodynamics, which will accelerate glomerulosclerosis and interstitial fibrosis. In addition, certain genetic polymorphisms are shown to be associated with aggressive CKD. Example is association of ACE gene in an individual who already has IgA nephropathy. And then there are modifiable risk factors, which I will discuss with you later. That's about etiologies. So what about complications of childhood CKD? Growth impairment is the most visible and the unique complication of pediatric CKD. Significant slowing of growth is common during all stages of CKD, and worsening effects are seen as GFR reduces. And the early onset CKD has the greatest risk. If you look at this growth velocity curve, the growth velocity is highest during infancy. And an average infant will achieve a height increment of 30 to 35 centimeters during the first 2 years of life. This is approximately 1/3 of the total postnatal growth. Therefore, very early onset illnesses affect the growth most. And during the first 2 years, the main contributory factor for poor growth is inadequate nutrition. And by optimizing caloric intake to at least 80% of the requirement can significantly improve nutrition and growth in these children. After 2 years, poor growth is mainly due to disturbances of growth hormone and its main mediator, IGF-1. Therefore, administration of growth hormone can improve growth after 2 years of age. However, optimizing nutrition is very important in all age groups. And then there are other contributory factors which may play important roles as eGFR declines further, like metabolic acidosis, mineral and bone disorders, anemia, fluid and electrolyte abnormalities. And children with structural disorders of kidneys usually have tubulopathies, polyuria, and salt wasting. And chronic dehydration and hyponatremia are well known to cause poor growth. In addition to this, the excess fluid intake kills the appetite and again can indirectly affect growth as well. This infant girl was presented to us with CKD during the first week of life, and she was producing more than 1 liter of urine. So we had to give a similar amount of fluid for her to prevent serum creatinine from rising further. And this was impossible via the oral route. And creation of this gastrostomy feeding tube not only supported us to hydrate her, but also supported us to improve her nutrition. So her growth, nutrition, as well as growth was well maintained until 1.5 years when she reached end stage, and subsequently she successfully underwent a kidney transplant. There are many flawed facts associated with nutrition in pediatric CKD. When a child is diagnosed with CKD, a common myth is that we have to avoid potassium in all patients. And also, most all patients are prescribed a low protein and low phosphate diet. Tubulopathies are common in congenital abnormalities of kidney and urinary tract, and most of them lose salt as well as potassium and may need salt and even potassium supplements, especially during early stages. And children need more energy and also protein for growth. This table illustrates the recommended dietary protein intake in children in CKD stages 3 to 5 and 5D. 5D is those children on dialysis. So the second column in red shows the daily recommended intake of a normal child. So if we look carefully, we can see the recommendation of protein intake for CKD stage 3 is 100 to 140% of the normal DRI. That is common for all ages, and it's not never below DRI. And for those in CKD stage 4 to 5, the recommended intake is 100 to 120% of DRI. And the minimum protein requirement for those on dialysis is always higher than the DRI. This is compensate for the extra losses during dialysis. And to facilitate bone growth, the calcium as well as phosphate requirements in childhood is much higher. We can see that the normal phosphate values of an infant is nearly double that of an adult. So one has to be very cautious in interpreting certain lab reports which gives only adult normative values. And also, we have to be very careful when restricting phosphate, because all diet that is rich in phosphate is rich in protein as well. So it's not possible to cut down phosphate without restricting protein. Phosphate binders should be started when serum phosphate levels exceeds the age-specific upper limit, and dietary phosphate restriction only up to 80% of DRI is recommended. When there is secondary hyperparathyroidism associated with hyperphosphatemia. Even though the nutrition requirements in CKD is very high, it is extremely difficult to optimize nutrition. For obvious reasons, the appetite of the child is gone. And during advanced stages, it's not possible to avoid many dietary restrictions on items they like to eat. And towards end stage, the optimizing nutrition is even more difficult due to extreme fluid restriction for the anuric and oliguric child, because this is especially more challenging in infants and young children, because most of the food items they love come in liquid form. Therefore, many alternative methods have to be tried. NG tube feeding is a good method, especially for infants, but that is with the hassle of a hanging tube. Gastrostomy or jejunostomy feeding is a better option, but in both methods, the food should come in liquid form. So this becomes a problem in anuric and the oliguric child who are on quite restricted fluid regimes. Intradialytic parenteral nutrition is a much better option for children on hemodialysis, because the extra amount of fluid we give as IDPN can be removed during dialysis itself and preventing volume overload. And also we can practice feeding during dialysis. This is a bit of a controversial issue. Generally, feeding during dialysis is not advised due to the risk of hypovolemia. However, in some children, especially the young ones, avoiding food during dialysis is not possible, because they will not allow you to dialyze unless you feed them. So our practice was, our policy was not to interfere with their food unless the food interferes with our dialysis. And most of the time it didn't. And we also have found that by providing food during dialysis actually avoids hypoglycemia during the session and also improves their nutrition. And what the other thing we have experienced is most of these children lose their appetite during the interdialytic period on the days they are not on dialysis. This is most probably secondary to accumulation of uremic toxins and many other measurable and unmeasurable toxins. But when these toxins are removed during dialysis, they regain the appetite and they become very hungry. Actually, later only we found that in KDOQI guidelines, intradialytic feeding is recommended in children to improve the nutrition they tolerate. Anemia is again another common complication of CKD. Therefore, hemoglobin should be periodically assessed in all children with CKD. So what is the cutoff hemoglobin value to initiate workup for anemia? I will give the answer for that as well. Approximately, when the HB hemoglobin is below the 5th percentile for age and sex, we have to start the workup for anemia. However, the normal ranges widely change between each age groups and also according to the gender. Therefore, these modified cutoff values have come up or have been proposed by KDIGO in 2012. For those up to 5 years, the cutoff is 11. 5 to 12, 11.5. After 12 years, the cutoff is 12. But for males after 15 years, the cutoff is up to 30. What are the common causes of anemia in CKD? Erythropoietin deficiency is almost always seen in advanced stages, but it can be visible even in stage 2. And iron deficiency is extremely common. Maybe due to dietary factors, frequent blood loss, and also rising hepcidine. Hepcidine accumulates as GFR reduces, and hepcidine reduces iron absorption from the gut and also inhibit release of iron from the reticular endothelial system. And hepcidine is a key mediator of functional iron deficiency. Chronic inflammation increases hepcidine and also suppresses erythropoietin production and may suppress bone marrow function as well. And then there can be deficiencies of other raw materials, especially folic acid and also B12 and even carnitine, especially during dialysis, because carnitine is removed during dialysis. And the red cell survival is reduced in CKD due to uremia and accumulation of many other toxins. So treatment of anemia. Erythropoietin is a major treatment method and that which is needed for most patients in advanced stages. And for those on dialysis, hemodialysis, it can be given intravenous. But for those on peritoneal dialysis and other pre-dialysis patients, erythropoietin is usually administered via subcut route. It's important to note that those who are on subcut erythropoietin, the injection can be given as a home-based treatment. And there's no need to admit these patients. As in the same way, the parents are treated to administer insulin, the parents can still be trained to administer erythropoietin as well. And all patients with anemia should be supplemented with iron, and it's a must before you start erythropoietin. And it can be given via oral route to most of these patients, but towards advanced stages, the gut absorption is quite impaired. Therefore, they will need intravenous iron supplementation and need to correct other deficiencies. And routine usage of folic acid have shown to improve anemia in CKD, pediatric CKD patients. And B12 also, and also vitamin D has to be supplemented in deficient cases. And vitamin D levels have shown to inversely correlate with hepcidin levels. Routine addition of vitamin C is not recommended, because vitamin C can cause hyperoxaluria and lead to calcification. And there's no proven benefit of routine administration of carnitine either. So what is the target hemoglobin level for a treated patient? So our target is to achieve hemoglobin values of 11 to 12 for all age groups. But for individual patients, even higher levels may be accepted, but should not exceed 13 grams per deciliter. And it's important to remember, we have to avoid blood transfusions at all costs. This can be achieved by early identification of anemia and correcting the deficiencies, and starting treatment as early as possible. And blood transfusion should be given only for those patients who are symptomatic or at risk of hypoxia, like in ventilated patients or having some lung complications. Others, we should always try to minimize it. And the need of blood transfusion again can be minimized by avoiding unnecessary investigations in the anemic patients, unnecessary blood drawing. And if the transfusion is unavoidable, we should always use leukodepleted blood. This is to prevent or minimize the sensitization, which will be a major risk after renal transplant to develop rejections. Cardiovascular disease is a major cause of mortality in dialysis patients, affecting nearly 30 to 50% of all deaths. So what are the cardiovascular risk factors? Hypertension and volume overload are quite common in the CKD population, and also anemia and dyslipidemia. Hyperparathyroidism can lead to extravascular calcification, arteriosclerosis and atherosclerosis, and uremia and hyperuricemia, and accumulation of other toxin products can increase the cardiovascular morbidity. So what are the causes of hypertension? The major etiopathology of hypertension in pre-dialysis patient is overactivation of renin-angiotensin aldosterone system. However, fluid overload is again a major factor when they become oliguric and on dialysis. And then the dietary factors like high salt intake and also metabolic syndrome is also not uncommon in the CKD population. So effective management of hypertension has shown to significantly reduce the cardiovascular morbidity, and also delay the progression of kidney damage. So what are the blood pressure targets? For primary hypertension, our aim is usually to keep blood pressure below the 90th percentile. And after 13 years, keep it below 130/80. However, aggressive blood pressure control is essential for CKD patients to minimize target organ damage. And studies done on CKD patients using ambulatory blood pressure monitoring have shown that maintaining the 24-hour mean arterial pressure below 50th percentile is associated with lowest target organ damage. We do not have data for clinic blood pressure or the office blood pressure measurements, the snapshot measurement, but the accepted practice is to keep our manual or the office blood pressure measurements also around 50th percentile to minimize the target organ damage. CKD and mineral and bone disease and renal osteodystrophy is again a very common complication. CKD-MBD is a systemic disorder of mineral and bone metabolism due to complex interplay among the kidney, bone, and the parathyroid glands in patients with CKD. So all these components are interlinked and we cannot manage one without addressing the other. Renal osteodystrophy is the skeletal component of this wider clinical syndrome of metabolic bone disease. And the manifestations may be clinical and radiological, biochemical, and even histological. Most common clinical features are fractures, bone deformities, and very importantly, poor growth, and also proximal myopathy. And towards later stages, there will be complications due to hypercalcemia and hyperphosphatemia leading to extra-skeletal calcification, which will be manifested as red dyes, pruritus, and even GI complications. And the first biochemical abnormality is actually rising fibroblast growth factor 23, but this is not measurable. But as GFR reduces, hypophosphatemia will be evident. And initially, there will be hypocalcemia. However, in treated patients, especially when they are in dialysis, hypercalcemia associated with many drugs we used and vitamin D products, hypercalcemia is more common than hypocalcemia. And then we have problems of secondary hypoparathyroidism and altered vitamin D metabolism. By definition, renal osteodystrophy is actually the histological alteration of the bone turnover and mineralization. The therapeutic approaches of MBD should aim at preventing renal osteodystrophy while minimizing extraskeletal calcification, especially intravascular calcification, which has a very high risk of morbidity and mortality. So our treatment should aim at controlling hyperphosphatemia, secondary hyperparathyroidism, and serum calcium levels. And management depends on individual patients. Therefore, routine prescription of calcium, phosphate binders, or vitamin D is not advisable. So when the GFR declines further and the child reaches end-stage renal disease, we need to think about renal replacement therapy. Available modalities are hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis, and kidney transplant. So I'm not going to give you the indications for renal replacement therapy, but you should know that. The principles of pediatric hemodialysis are more or less similar to adults, but you need size-matched accessories. One of the common arguments of my adult colleagues are, why you need so many sizes? Why can't you just go for one pediatric size? But not the same fit suits every child. Not even a smaller version of the same design, because children have unique requirements and they come from very different sizes. And the procedure of hemodialysis, like everything else in pediatric practice, should be very gentle and should have low flow rates. And you also need specific machines which allow these low rates and also to which these tiny appliances can be fitted. Managing infants and toddlers during dialysis is an art. Even the smallest movement may give trouble. But you can't keep these children sedated during each and every session. However, within the loving care will do the trick most of the time. And children on hemodialysis need minimum 3 times a week hemodialysis. And this is essential for anuric child. Smaller children need even more frequent hemodialysis, which means frequent hospital visits and is a huge burden to parents and also to health systems, which run with limited facilities. And then you have problems of vascular access and catheter-related infections. And with hemodialysis, which is given 3 times a week, it's not easy to meet the fluid demand of the young child, and they often come fluid overloaded. So home peritoneal dialysis is a better choice, but you need trained, dedicated staff who are motivated to do this, and also backup technical support. So far, we have trained more than 20 patients in our home peritoneal dialysis program, and most of them actually have been doing fantastically well. They attend to their day-to-day activities with less restrictions, and the fluid clearance also is better, so they can bring more fluid. And those children who were previously on hemodialysis actually like the change much better. But the drawbacks of peritoneal dialysis again is risk of peritonitis, bacterial, and also rarely fungal infections. And then there can be herniation, incisional hernias, or opening of the physiological hernia spaces, like inguinal hernias. And when the children are on peritoneal dialysis for long duration, the peritoneum can fail. It can undergo sclerosis. However, this child who is in this picture underwent peritoneal dialysis for more than 2 years because he was in the waiting list for kidney transplant. He didn't have a donor. Actually, he only had problems of inguinal hernia once, which was repaired, but other than that, he never had peritonitis and no other complications. And he attended school without any issue before the corona period, actually, and also sat for the O-level exam also before he underwent kidney transplant. Another problem is the poor home environments. These children also, sometimes we can arrange dialysis with some modifications. This is the home setup of one of those children. The family of this child only had one compartment for everything, you know, for cooking, sleeping, everything. But these parents managed to arrange makeshift room in this tiny apartment. And this child continued his peritoneal dialysis in this makeshift room until the time he underwent kidney transplant. However, some children come from poorest of the poor families and from very rural areas who do not have even running water, which is an essential requirement for peritoneal dialysis. For these children, hemodialysis is the only choice. And during the management of CKD, one should never forget the immense number of the massive amounts of psychosocial issues these children undergo. And also do not forget management of the family. One of the major differences in the pediatric and the adult medicine is the care for child should always be delivered through a caregiver. Therefore, this care plan should be linked with the needs of all family members, and the family should know what to expect during their journeys, which necessitate more than 1 or 2 counseling sessions and family conferences. And it's very important for the parents to understand that they are going to make a lifetime commitment for this child. This particular child came from Jaffna. And after initiation of dialysis with all his tiny pediatric appliances, we transferred him to Jaffna. Geodal nephrologist there was very helpful. and they continued dialysis there. So we managed like virtual. But within a month's time, the child was transferred back to us. He was fluidly overloaded, was in heart failure with ejection fraction of 30%. And he was so much overloaded. Even daily dialysis was not effective to remove fluid from this mother, from this parent. The mother was like swearing that she gave only 400 ml of fluid for this child. With careful observation, we found that this child was grabbing whatever the fluid in his vicinity when the mother was not around. He was drinking from taps and during showers, and more the advices he got, more he drank. This is the rebel inside the child with chronic disorders, a disability due to ill health and many devices. All he is only do's and don'ts. Therefore, he despises advices and always decide to disobey. How to overcome this problem? We need to find mechanisms to release the exploding internal energy of childhood. This can be achieved by adding some value to their restricted hospital life. We have to provide some sort of entertainment even while in hospital, and we have to keep these children occupied, and we need to show them we do care. Maybe holding small parties, giving small presents, and just talking to them when you're talking by. Of course, we could do all these things during the pre-corona era. Now it's not possible, sadly. And most of all, these children need some hope for survival. The biggest hope of most of these children is to have a renal transplant, to have a life without dialysis, so he can enjoy his favorite drink without any restriction. Renal transplant provides significant improvement of quality of life for these children. And even with the best of the care, it is extremely difficult to achieve optimum growth, especially in the dialyzed child. But renal transplant significantly improves growth in these children. And patient survival can be quite high, as 98% at 10 years with advanced new medical treatments. And the graft survival can be as high as 60% at 10 years. However, they should be on lifetime immunosuppressants, and then there are associated complications of these drugs. Therefore, more emphasis should always be focused on preventing CKD and end-stage renal disease. So early identification of CKD is very important. Most of the children during the early CKD period are asymptomatic, even though they can have problems like growth failure or subtle voiding problems. In our culture, these are quite considered as norms. So when the child reaches end stage, he becomes suddenly very ill. So breaking this news to the parents is a nightmare to all physicians, because it's very difficult for the parents to accept the fact that the child who was just running around happily was actually carrying a devastating disease. So with early identification, we can prepare the family early. And also we can identify and treat the reversible factors, and by that we can delay the progression of chronic kidney disease and prevent comorbidities, and also we can optimally prepare the child for kidney transfer. So we need to actively investigate and treat the reversible factors. And there can be many chronic insults like hypertension, proteinuria, obesity, mineral bones, hyperuricemia, and smoking in young adolescents, and anemia. Correction of these will significantly delay the progression. And then there are acute insults, very important, dehydration, infection, correction of hypertension, avoiding nephrotoxic drugs, and correction of obstructive uropathies. Treat autoimmune diseases. This can prevent CKD or at least delay the progression into end-stage renal disease. Spinal dysraphism is a very good example. Almost all children with lower spinal defects get bladder bowel involved, and majority end up in end-stage renal disease without bladder care. When I came to LRH in 2019, during that year itself, more than 4 children were referred to us with end-stage renal disease having a neurogenic bladder. None of them had bladder plans, and bladder care was not available at that time. So we had to, you know, painfully watch them die. Sadly, or fortunately, these children have excellent brain functions, and some of them will be having good lower limb mobility and also satisfactory kidney reserve at birth. So with optimum care, these children can have a near normal life. So we started our neurogenic bladder training program in 2009. I think we have trained like approximately at least 300 children. And one of our early pilot studies showed that over 80% of them had no wetting, no swelling, and had normal EGF. Of course, some there could have been defaulty, so we may have missed some children, you know, who have complications. But the good thing is, we did not get children in end stage as we used to have. During the last 10 years, we only got one child who reached end stage with an associated neurogenic bladder. I think that was a great achievement. And posterior urethral valve is a major cause of CKD in boys, and 20 to 30% of these children reach end stage before adulthood. Most of them have dysplastic kidneys, which is the reason for end-stage renal disease. And also, it may be due to exposure to other preventable acute medical insults. And also, some children still have ongoing problems in the bladder, which is called valve bladder. So by appropriately handling these bladders and preventing these other reversible insults, the progression of kidney disease can be largely altered in these children as well. And even if they go into end stage, these bladders should be surgically optimized before kidney transplant. Otherwise, the transplanted kidney also will face the same fate. Okay, so we come to the MCQs. Come to the end of our talk now. So there are a few take-home messages. CKD has many unique challenges. Potential optimized group and nutrition for other complications such as fluid electrolyte abnormalities, anemia, mineral bone disease, acidosis, hypertension. Appropriate management of these complications improves quality of life, minimize the target organ damage, especially the cardiovascular morbidity. And early identification of CKD is very important, and all efforts should be made to identify and treat the reversible factors. And more emphasis should be exerted on primary prevention. And the patient and the family should be counseled and prepared for the long journey with adequate psychosocial support. And as a last message, I would like to again repeat, avoid blood transfusion unless it is really, really essential.